If you're ready, we can start this first session on regional convergence in Russia and job creation effects or lending in international perspective. And first paper is by Yelena Vakulenko, to whom I give the floor. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for being here. I'd like to present you a paper which we did together with Sergei Guriev. It's a paper about convergence among Russian regions. And firstly, a few words about motivation. Why we decide to do such work? As we know, Russia now is a market economy. But in the 90s, it was the Soviet Union, and we had planned economy. So during this year, we can see such called as transition period for our economy. And we know that during Soviet industrialization, relocation of our resources, labor resources, and also capital resources, was driven but not market forces, by government forces. So people, government decided to do so a lot of monotones because they so thought that they believe to economy of scale, not to the competition. So geographic allocation of production was inefficient. And transition to market was to involve not only labor mobility, but also geographical mobility. In the 90s, we didn't see convergence between Russian regions by different indicators, but through 10 years, from 2000 years, we can see convergence by different indicators. And our main idea is to try to explain why we can see such effect. And we explained this fact by different ways and do some different empirical exercises. And today I'd like to present these exercises and our main results which we received. And in this map, this graph, you can see a dynamic of population weight and standard deviation for different indicators, such as income per capita, wage, unemployment rate, and GDP per capita. This is all indicators in comparable prices, so we divide nominal indicators to minimal subsistence level. And you can see that, for example, the red line is for the income. This is real income. And population weight standard deviation for these indicators from 2000 declines rapidly, and we can say that we see so-called sigma convergence, when we see, see the relative differences between regions. For example, for wage, such increasing also the risk from 2008. For unemployment, such facts we can see only from 2005, but it's very interesting fact that for GDP per capita, this is a dashed line, we haven't got such convergence. And in order to compare difference in Russia with other countries, we use data from a paper Chi and Spillingberger 2012 and try to compare Russian differences between regions, Russian inequality, with other countries. And in this graph, on the horizontal line, this is the average log of regional GDP dispersion, which is calculated by methodology of Chi and Spillingberger. And on the vertical line, you can see the average logarithm of GDP per capita from 1995 to 2005. And in this graph, you can see the strong negative relationship between regional dispersion and GDP per capita. In those countries where dispersion is bigger, the GDP per capita is lower. And red dots is for Russia for different periods of time. This is 1995, this is 2010, and this is for the average period. And we can mention that Russia the differences between regions for Russia is much more higher than for other countries. And that's why also GDP per capita is lower for Russia than for other countries. And in order to compare the dynamics of convergence for different countries, we can see for this graph. This is also population-weighted standard deviation on top of real income for USA, Russia, European Union. We consider European Union as one country, different countries of European Union as one country. we use the separation. And also separately Western Europe. And what we can mention in this map that situation for Russia is a gray line. At the end, to the end of 2000 years, becomes similar to the European Union countries. So the differences in income for Russia becomes similar to European countries level. And this is situation for unemployment rate. Also, Russia is a gray line, and dotted line is European Union countries. And as in the previous graph, you can see that at the end of 2000 years, our situation is much more similar to the European countries. And this is one way of measuring convergence. As I say, said, it is a so-called sigma convergence, when we consider the relative relationship between regions. Another way is to estimate so-called beta convergence or absolute convergence. And this is a situation when we compare initial level of indicators such as GDP per capita or income or some other indicators with the annual growth rate for these indicators. And if we receive a negative relationship between these two indicators, we call that there is a convergence, because initially poor regions growth faster than those regions which initially was poor, was richer. And but this way it's not good, because we can't say that the differences between regions, inequality between regions, decrease if there is a better convergence, because it's absolute convergence. They are converge to some steady-state level, and these steady-state levels match may be different for different regions, not once. So we also try to estimate this way, and in this table you can see the beta convergence and speed of beta convergence. This is column which I call beta for different time periods and for different indicators. First column is for income per capita, the second is for real wage, and the last is for real GDP per capita. And this is, in this slide you can see, but in my computer there is a gray matrices, 8.2. This is the biggest speed of convergence for income in 2005-2010, and for wage, for example, the biggest is for the first 5 years of 2000 years. We also can mention that if there is better sigma convergence, beta convergence also there is, but the inverse relationship is not maybe not true. And our main question: why accelerated convergence in 2000 years? And we have three ways why it is so. One of them is labor mobility. So people move from one region to another, and as a labor supply from neoclassical model, it can help to converge the region. And why it may be so? Maybe there is a development of financial and real estate markets, or maybe overall growth of Russian economy, and which helps to break it out of poverty traps for migration. Because in paper Gurifan and Renka was shown that for Russia in the 90s, it was a poverty trap for Russian economy. People can't migrate from one region to another because they haven't got money in order to move from one region to another. And we try to estimate if there is such situation now. So if there is so-called liquidity constraints and people can move or not. Another explanation is capital mobility. So also not labor, but also capital can mobile from one region to another. And this also can help to equalize the difference between regions by different indicators. And the last explanation about fiscal distribution. So also not only flows of capital labor, but also government decision from rich region, we receive money from rich region and as different tax laws redistribute money for poor regions. And we try to check three these ways. And how we answer this question? We do different empirical exercises, and one of them is about decomposition. We, as I mentioned before, for our analysis is more interesting sigma convergence than beta convergence. And we try to decompose the convergence process, so-called Gini coefficient. This is similar to standard deviation because they show much more similar ways. And try to decompose the Gini coefficient for income for different sources of income, such as wages, government transfers, and other incomes. The next exercise is about testing whether interregional migration increased or decreased, and which barriers to migration flows were building during this period of time. So we check and test different barriers, if there is barriers for migration or not. And the last exercise is about the similar testing as for migration flow to capital flow. And first, our part is about decomposition of convergence. And we use Shorrock's methodology. This is a year of this work. And what we do, the highest line on this graph is dynamic of Gini coefficient for real income. And this is true three lines. This is a part of this Gini coefficient for different sources, such as the gray line is for other incomes, dotted line is for wage, and the last is for social transfers. Other incomes include such incomes as entrepreneurial income, rental incomes, and also informal sector, also in these sources. And what we can see that their main part of Gini coefficient is other incomes for the beginnings of 90s and also 2000 years, but after the some period of time, after the 2008, the main role was for the wage, which also converged. And also it's important to mention that there are sources, such sources as social transfers, which includes pensions, grants, social benefits, and so on, governmental payments, is very low. The share of such payment in Gini coefficient. Of course, in the, so according to this graph, we can see that the role of government in convergence between regions, sigma convergence between regions, is very low because this share in our decomposition is low. However, we can't say that such kind of sources of inequality as government or public wage, it is also a part of wage, not a social transfers. So government can, for example, redistribute sources by public wage, but not only social transfers. But during this, according to this graph, the main source of convergence is the so-called other incomes part. This is the same methodology we try to use for the composition of Gini coefficient for GDP per capita, also in real prices. But as I mentioned earlier, the GDP per capita doesn't converge during the 2000 years, but as in previous graph, the main source of main share of Gini coefficient also the other incomes. And now about the second way of testing our hypothesis about labor mobility. And firstly, in order to understand which is the dynamic of our labor forces, we have only figures about internal migration, but we can't say is it labor mobility or something like others. This is also only a total amount of people which migrate from one region to another. And red line is overall Russian migration flow as percent of population. And we can see that from 1990 to 2010, this rate declines all the time. And from 2000 to 2010, it stabilized on some level, which is around 1.5%. And this is more 2 million people per year. And this is the total amount, inter-regional migration and also intra-regional. And we can say that this is the total amount divided separately between inter-regional and inter-regional migration. And in this way, first question is, so the number of people which migrate declines, so maybe a convergence for these indicators, for income and wage also there is. And the question is, maybe there is some barriers for migration, people can't migrate, or maybe another explanation of this fact. This is about the destination, in which region people live. In this map you can see different colors. The white colors, this is net migration for the period from 1995 to 2010, the share of 1995 population. And we can see that, for example, for our eastern part of Russia, for example, Chukotka, 50% of population during this year migrate from this part of Russia to western part. And all eastern part is in white colors, not so black as the western. And in literature, this fact called western need. And of course, for example, for Moscow, this is net migration, only the migration is the highest. 30% of population in Moscow is through the migration. And in order to compare figures for Russia with other countries, we calculate inter-regional migration as a percent of population for Russia and other countries. This is also inter-regional. And we can see that for Russia, it's around 0.6% during all 2000 years. It's approximately the same as for European Union countries, if we consider 27 countries. And for USA, for example, New Zealand, Japan, Canada, it's figures much more higher than for Russia. Of course, I'd like to mention that we consider only registered migration flows. So in Russian statistics, we calculate migration only in those cases, if people registered when they move from one place to another. And now about modeling. How we modeling migration flows? We consider usual modified gravity model in which the dependent variable is a logarithm of a migration flow from region to destination. And this is a sum, so-called power between this region, which is explained by distance between this region, logarithm of population in Norwegian region, in destination, logarithm of income per capita in region and destination, and different indicators of quality of life, such as public goods, health, education, and so on. A lot of different indicators, we can see these indicators in our paper. And our prediction. The main interest for us is income and also different financial indicators of this equation. We expect that migration flow increases in income in destination region and public goods in destination region, and decreases in income in origins region and also research for public goods. So people move to region where income is bigger, from region where income is lower. This is our prediction. However, we consider the such theoretical model where we suppose financial constraints for migrants. So this is the distribution of migration from region I, from origin region, as a function of average income in origin region. And the relationship between these two indicators is not linear. We can see in our paper more detailed this theoretical model, but the idea is the problem. When the income is low, people migration from this region increase if income increase in this region. Because in first, when the income is very low, from zero to some point, people can't migrate. Migration level is zero because they haven't got special money, they can't pay for this transportation cost and other migration costs. But when the income increases, people decide to migrate from this region and migration increase this income. After some point, see that migration is stable, and if the average income is rather high in region, migration decreases. So people don't want to move from region where income is rather higher. And we try to test such hypothesis on our data. So we try to estimate different model with non-linear relationship between migration and average income in origin region. And first idea is the simple idea. We try to estimate the quadratic form between migration and income from origin region. And we can see that there is such a negative parabolistic form, and there is a peak after such point people decide to, before this point, migration increase, after this point, migration decrease. So we have the parabolistic form which have peak in our data. And we try to estimate this model for different numbers of the observation with Moscow and St. Petersburg, with Caucasian Republic and others. So we try to check our results. Also, we try to estimate non-parametric models. In this kind, we estimate semi-parametric because we suppose only non-parametric relationship between migration and income. And you can see the graphs as a result of our estimation. So, as in previous estimation, there is a such point before which migration increase and after which migration decrease. And also we try to estimate so-called model with structural break in order to find this threshold. And in this table, this is the value of our threshold which we estimate for different model, for model with squared income, for non-parametric model, and models with structural break. This is the first column. This is our threshold in the logarithm of real income. This is called confidence interval. I can see the confidence interval for this point. And we estimated these figures in Russian rubles in 2010. And you can see that this is threshold is between 6,000 to 10,000 rubles in rubles of 2010. So regions in which income is lower than this figure, from this region people can't move, and migration increase with increasing income. And after this point, people decide to stay in this, in here, their region. And in order to estimate the number of regions which is in this poverty trap, we consider the dynamic of distribution of regions by real income. This is decimals of percentiles of our income distribution. They are 30%, 50%, 70%, or 30%. And we can see, for example, if we take their threshold as 9, the number of regions with income which is below this level is huge for the 19th year, and after the 2005, for example, there is no such regions which is in poverty again. And if we try to estimate it more accurate, we can say that the log real income, if it's a 9, it's around 8,000 rubles. And in 1995, 89% regions were in poverty trap. In 2000, it's only 84, and in 2005, 97. And in the last of our period, 2010, only one region, Kalmykia, was in poverty trap. And also, we tried to estimate financial development, how it's affect migration flows. And our hypothesis was that financial development relaxes the liquidity constraints. And we also received that as a poverty trap, financial development also results in higher outward migration. And the main result that now we haven't got such problem with poverty trap is earlier. And the last part of my presentation, it is about capital mobility. We try to estimate model for capital mobility, also on panel data, with fixed effect and time effect in the previous way. But as you know, there is no such indicators in our Russian statistics as capital flow. So we try to estimate such indicators as difference between investment and savings, and plus the government debt of consolidated budget. And we estimate the model where this variable was a dependent variable, it was a dependent variable, as a function of such indicators as income per capita and region, lack of logarithm of capital income per unit of capital. We call this as a variable as return of investment. This is a relationship between capital and employment, fixed effect, yield dynamics, and a lot of controls, not to include different ways. And also we estimate model for investment. For investment, model much more similar, but the dependent variable now is investment. And the main interest is the coefficient beta 1, the relationship between savings and investment. And also in this model, there is a budget income, budget expenditures, as the previous slide, also return on capital and other variables. And main results, capital flows to regions with high returns to capital and lower wages and incomes. And that's why capital mobility contribute to convergence, because capital flow flows to the region with higher returns but lower income. And we find that there is no significant relationship between investment and savings in the second model. And so we can reject the hypothesis that there are interregional barriers to capital mobility. And now about conclusion. Three part of presentation and three part of conclusions. One of them about the decomposition and overall convergence in 2000s years, especially in the late of 2000s. Substantial convergence in incomes and wages, as I showed. By 2000, our difference between our regions becomes as for European levels. Direct government transfers didn't contribute to the convergence because their role is very small in gene decomposition. In early 2000, convergence was explained mainly by wages and in later years by other incomes. The second conclusion about the labor mobility, we find that there is no poverty traps, and we find a reduction in barriers to labor mobility, and our explanation why the number of migrants decrease is that there is an overall economic growth, and convergence between regions, incomes becomes more close to each other, and this maybe is the factors which declines our migration between regions. And also financial development has also contributed to reflecting liquidity constraints. About this model I said only a few words. And the last conclusions about capital flows. As I said, capital flows to regions with high returns and with lower wages, and thus contributes to convergence. And investment in Russia regions is not correlated with savings, and which suggests that capital market is not regionally segmented. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Yelena, for your clear presentation. I now would like to ask you if you have questions about this paper.
I have a lot of questions, but I'll ask only one.
You can ask after.
Only one. Yes. I think it would be more convenient if I ask it on the basis of your nominal values for wages, other incomes, and GDP. I look at your table number 13.
Appendix.
Yeah. And I see that for some periods there was convergence in terms of other incomes. There was convergence in terms of wages. But there was divergence in terms of regional GDPs. Mm-hmm. My question is how is this possible? We know that there is a very strong positive correlation between regional indicators of wages and other incomes per capita. It seems that this strange combination might be explained only by some statistical tricks. Only economic explanation that I can see is associated with the third element of regional GDP. I mean net taxes on products. We know that variation in this indicator is very huge. The share of net taxes in Moscow is less than 1% of regional GDP. In Tumen, it is near 40%. So maybe there was some growth in regional inequality in these terms, because either this might be associated with some statistical tricks. I don't see other way from this strange situation.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for a very important and interesting question, because we also, I agree with you, and also Sergei Maratovich also agree, that this is a puzzle, that we have a convergence in one indicators and divergence in nominal indicators for GDP. And we have some explanation in our conclusion in our paper that maybe it is through this so-called total factor productivity part in GDP, when we consider innovation, political side, and other side of explanation growth in the regional. But now we have not got a strong model which can explain this fact in more accuracy than only our assumptions why it's so.
Could I provide a short comment? I can't agree with this explanation, because I think this is purely statistical issue. This is a purely measurement issue. So, For this discrepancy between in behavior between wages and other incomes on the one side and GDP per capita on other side. So it can't be explained by some innovation on other factors. You should decompose GDP. You see three elements. You see divergence in two major elements. So how is it possible that you see divergence in total regional GDP? So.
Thank you. Yes, I agree. Yes, we can't answer very aggressively for this question. It's impossible for us.
So it's a measurement problem, I think.
Our measurement problem or our statistical agency?
Okay, you can perhaps discuss this also later. If you have other questions, please.
Maybe one way to look at this paradox would be to keep in mind that the Russian economy, at least if looked from outside, is very much resource dependent. And maybe this variation in local taxes also has something to do with extraction fees and things of that sort. Because otherwise, I mean, we are left with an impression of the Russian economy that this is a perfectly functioning market economy. There are no barriers to migration. There are no entry barriers for capital mobility and things like that. And when we listened yesterday to Michal Rutkowski, then the World Bank is now, let's say, rolling out a program to understand product market regulation in 30 different regions in Russia, which would not make any sense if there wouldn't be, let's say, regionalized entry barriers or region-specific barriers to capital mobility. And therefore, I think, my question would be whether you have made an effort to distinguish between regions that sort of follow normal market economy principles, combining labor and capital and producing something, and regions that are dominated by resource extraction.
So this is your question or your suggestion? The question. Maybe you're right, and we try to divide our regions to two groups, for resource dependent and another region. But now we can't try to. We didn't try to do this. I think it's interesting idea. We try. Maybe you're right, and this is important that why this is so situation. We have. A paper together with Yusei Gurvich and Pavel Krivenko, where we consider the dependence of our economy from oil price, oil and budget regulation, budget policy. And we receive that it's very, our Russian economy is very dependent on oil price and, of course, it's resource economy. Maybe it's useful to try to divide in such a way. Thank you.
Any other question? Please.
Have, two questions. Where did you take data on interregional capital flows? And the next question, did you estimate whether migration may contribute to convergence or not?
Yes, thank you very much for your questions. Firstly, about the second questions. This is my paper, which I do now. I try to estimate conditional beta convergence model, in which I try to find the effect of migration to the convergence in a direct way, not in as indirect as we try in this paper. So this is my paper in which I do now, so I can't present this result, but I think about this. And about figures of capital flow, as I mentioned, we haven't got such statistics. We calculate such indicators, which we call capital flow, as difference between investment and savings plus government debt or consolidated budget of the region. So we have investment for region, savings or household savings in the region, and the government debt of consolidated budget also for region on regional level. Calculating these figures, we receive our capital flow.
From which region this capital flow was?
No.
Okay, so that's not the same, exactly the same methodology.
This is stock, maybe not the not the stock, but it's not stock because yes, it's different. But yes, we don't know from which region as for migration. For migration, we have a matrices, and we know from which region to from which to which people move. But in this way, we have only one figure for one region, capital flow.
Thank you. If is any other question, I thank Yelena, and with great pleasure I give the floor to John Earle for his paper on job creation effects.
This is a brand new paper. Actually, it was finished a few weeks ago, but it took a while to get through the censors at the Census Bureau in Washington. They do I need? Because we're using data on every single employer business in the U.S. economy in this analysis. And I think that the question that we're asking, which is about small business programs, is one which is also relevant for this country and other economies of this region. And in fact, we have written papers on this topic using Romanian data as well. But because these results are so fresh, and this is my first opportunity to present them, I actually would like to focus on the U.S. results. If anyone has access to similar Russian data, I would be very happy to participate in a study of this question here. So this is the mandatory disclaimer about the data, and the Census Bureau doesn't necessarily agree with any of our conclusions. So we want to ask this question: whether credit constraints are important in limiting job creation. And the Small Business Administration in the U.S. seems like a great case study for this, because they're supposed to focus on credit-constrained firms. and in fact, this has been around the world, but particularly in the U.S. in the last few years, great subject of discussion because There has been repeated statements, you could even hear it in the debate between Obama and Romney, which I only caught the first half an hour of before I was getting on my plane a few nights ago. In the first half an hour, they were both talking about small businesses are the job creators, and we have to support small businesses. It seems like it's the only policy that the two of them really agree about. But there has been an academic debate on whether most jobs are created by small businesses, as the original research by David Birch had claimed, and his research was attacked on various methodological grounds by Davis, Haltwinger, and Hsu initially, and more recently by this paper, Haltwinger, Jarman, and Miranda, which is forthcoming in the Restat. But none of that literature, none of that debate relates to the question about how the government should allocate any assistance that it's providing. So if you think that small businesses are the main job creators, well, maybe that means they're doing just fine, and actually the government should be assisting the big businesses. So it doesn't carry any direct implication for policy. And that's the question that we would like to address. Well, so do these policies actually affect job creation? in the credit boom prior to the crisis, maybe small and young firms didn't do as well, and it seems that in the credit crunch has been worse for them, so there have been all kinds of new policies proposed. These are U.S. data on changes in employment by firm size categories, and it does seem that in the recession that we have been experiencing, the job losses were actually larger in smaller firms. I haven't seen numbers like this for East European economies. So we would like to try to address this question, whether these loan programs help to create jobs. And actually, this question is even conceptually or theoretically ambiguous for lots of reasons. Because you may think that if it's cheaper to hire capital, that'll lead to expansion. But if capital and labor are gross substitutes, then that could actually lead to a decline in employment at these firms. And there may also be substitution effects. So by this, what I have in mind is there may be private sources of capital that are crowded out by the government program, and there may be displacement effects, which means that competing firms may simply lose business to the recipient firms, and so that the aggregate effect could be zero, even if the recipients benefit. But of course, it's also empirically difficult to analyze this. There are many factors that affect firm growth, and huge bodies of research investigating each of these factors. Maybe one that I would point out that is of special interest in many data sets has been hard to measure is firm age. So now that I have small children, I'm very aware that there's a big difference between a 3-year-old and a 5-year-old, and the same goes for firms. The firm size age relationship is, of course, concave, conditional on survival, and so growth rates are systematically declining with firms, just as they are with people. Just as with people, there is at some point that concavity actually leads to a negative slope. And of course, there's possible selection bias in which kinds of firms are receiving these loans. We don't know whether that's positive or negative. It might be positive if the loan officers or the decision makers, which varies across the types of programs we're looking at. But if these decision makers are trying to give the best candidates the loans, or maybe they're actually looking for the worst cases to try to help them out. Measuring displacement, the general equilibrium effects, is very difficult, and that's why in general, the program evaluation literature completely ignores general equilibrium effects. But we're going to try to look at them a little bit. So there are lots of firm growth studies, but essentially there have been no rigorous evaluations of loan policies just about anywhere. Okay, and this relates to some broader literatures about the role of finance in growth, and there's a causality issue there that's been debated back and forth. The deeper question is about the relationship of the real and monetary economy. of course, in analyzing credit constraints, the typical approach has been to look at the relationship between investment and cash flow. So if cash flow influences investment, then a firm looks credit constrained. But in all of these studies, there are very difficult problems of endogeneity. Most of the growth finance literature is actually at the aggregate level. So in the US, it might use states. In the Eurozone, it's using countries. And there are questions about extensive versus intensive margins along which finance can affect growth. So there's also, of course, the literature in transition economies. the international financial institutions for a long time were essentially equating the size of the new private business sector with progress in transition. The measurement issue is that new is not necessarily the same as small, and nonetheless, the World Bank has usually used the share of employment in small businesses as their measure of the new private sector. and the policy issue there, which has been debated a lot, is whether it's more valuable for international donors and advisors to promote better financial markets or to try to improve the business environment. And of course, the business environment got to be very fashionable some years ago. Papers by Simon Johnson and his co-authors arguing that finance is secondary. And there's a similar kind of literature in developing countries where the focus is more on microfinance, microcredit. But actually, it's interesting, even though there's a lot of research about this, there's very little, almost nothing, in fact, that looks at the firm level growth effects of microcredit programs. There have been experiments where the unit of observation is some geographic area, usually villages or slums, and what they do is they make credit available in some slums and not other slums and see the effects. And it's interesting in this small body of literature, I don't know, maybe half a dozen experiments have been carried out. There are some that find positive effects, some that find no effects, and it's not really clear why that is. Is it experimental design? Is it their time series are short? Their sample sizes are small? You know, they're using these aggregated units. So I wouldn't say that this issue is resolved in development economics either. Now, coming back to the Small Business Administration in the U.S., probably the best study, if you can imagine that, is one which uses local markets. So typically at the county level or metropolitan area, and compares growth or some kind of outcome measure, relates that in a regression or a simple correlation with the volume of SBA loans. And it seems that there's some weak positive relationship there. But this is also difficult to draw any strong conclusions from because, of course, there are lots of factors that affect growth within a geographic area, within a region of Russia. So, trying to tease out the effect of a small program like the SBA program would be difficult. There's other research on the default rates. There's been a couple of studies that were commissioned by the SBA, and I don't know, surprisingly or not, they find that the SBA has a big effect on survival and growth. These are these two studies that they commissioned, and the SBA itself actually advertises a number of jobs that were supposedly created by their loans each year in their annual reports, and the recent numbers have ranged between 500 and 600,000 jobs per year, so 500,000 or so jobs a year, which is, you know, not a small number. They never say in any of their reports, at least that I have managed to find, how they calculate this number. But it seems that the way that they do it is when an application is made for the SBA backing for a loan, one of the questions is, how many jobs will this loan create, and how many jobs will this loan lead to them being retained, or, you know, that would have been lost? And they just add up these two numbers and then sum them over all the loans that they give in a particular year, and that's the number they report. And they never actually go back and check, well, you know, what happened to these firms. And because their stated goal, so they have I read their strategic plan. I read their strategic plan, and their first strategic goal is creating jobs and growing small businesses. So, you know, so if you're applying for an SBA loan, you probably want to kind of overestimate on the high side, the high end of the distribution, of possible jobs created. Anyway, so this is a number they're reporting. So we are hoping that we can make a little bit of progress over the existing estimates using better data. Okay, so I can tell you a lot about these loan programs. The most important thing to understand is that these programs worked, the microcredit programs that we studied in Romania are direct loans, but the way these loans work is they're actually made by commercial lenders, and the SBA just provides a guarantee for some fraction of the loan, which ranges from 50 to 85%. And the median loan size is a little over $100,000. So these are not huge loans. They're not, I guess they're not tiny either. And there are two main programs that we're looking at, called the 7A and the 504 program. The results that I'm going to be showing you here are, we're just looking at these programs put together, also with without distinguishing different subcategories of the 7A program, which is the biggest program, and we're leaving that controversial subject for a future paper. it's interesting that the lender providing the loan has to stipulate that this firm couldn't be financed any other way. So the financial assistance applied for is not otherwise available on reasonable terms. Of course, what that means, you know, we don't know, but they have to stipulate that. So I'm going to skip over some of these institutional details. These are the numbers of loans and the volume in terms of loan amount on the left and the right vertical scales, respectively. the range over the period that we're going to be looking at from 1977 to 2009, there have been between 20,000 and 100,000 or so loans given out each year in the U.S., and the total value has been up to $30 billion. So this is the flow, not the stock. So these are the new loans issued in each of these years. Okay, the data that we're using include a complete list of all the loans that the SBA has ever given in the lifetime of that agency, going back to 1953. It took us about 2.5 years to get these data out of the SBA. Finally, we made a Freedom of Information Act request to get them. And we put these together with a longitudinal business database, which is the Census Bureau's data on every employer business in the U.S., non-farm, non-public administration business establishments. And these contain annual data going back to 1976. It's a big data set, of course, but it has very few variables in it. Basically, there's just employment and name and address and industry identifying information like that. Because the SBA refused to give us the employer tax ID, which would allow us to directly link between these two databases, we've had to link them using probabilistic matching on name, address, and zip code, because names and addresses can be written in a wide variety of ways. It's not necessarily that easy to link this way. So to illustrate that, this shows the relationship between the total number of loans of 1.4 million over this period. And we managed to link 763,000 of those. Now, some of them we're actually not interested in linking, so we focused only on employers, so non-employer businesses, so self-employed people. We're not studying here. We're also not interested in people who were in firms that received loans prior to 1977. We're studying only the first loans that businesses received, because the later loans, there's some other endogeneity issues that would crop up with those. We're not studying startup firms. We study one-year-old firms, but not startups. They don't have any history. We're not studying multi-establishment firms, because these firms, we measure employment growth at the establishment level, but we don't know when the firm gets a loan, which establishment it's using the loan for, and maybe it's using the loan to create a new establishment. That might be something worth looking into, but just to keep it simple, it doesn't exclude a whole lot, but we look only at single establishments. So we end up studying about 200,000 loans. This is telling you the difference across these groups in terms of their characteristics in the SBA data. So you can see some of the variables we have in the SBA data. The SBA is especially interested in trying to help minority and female and veteran-owned businesses. So they collect data on that, and we've actually run some regressions where we look at effects separately by those groups. but again, we're leaving that for further research. So essentially what we're doing here is something that resembles a conventional program evaluation. So we have our treated firms, and we'd like to select some controls which are similar in a specific sense, that is similar in terms of the outcomes that treated firms would have experienced had they not been treated. And because this is a longitudinal setting, we have long panel data. We're in some ways having to make up methods as we go along to use the panel. So we're using the panel for matching, and then we use the match data in panel regression, including firm fixed effects, and also taking into account the timing of the loan within the match sample. So It's not completely clear, of course, that this eliminates any potential endogeneity, so we're going to look at some specification tests that I'll discuss in a second. So we're constructing the control group and carrying out these panel difference and differences regressions. we're looking at the dynamics of the effect prior to the loan and in the post period. One interesting question is, well, maybe this this loan leads to growth, which is just temporary, and then the firm reverts after a few years to its former size. we do exact matching on a bunch of variables. The data set is huge, so we're able to do this, detailed industry. Sometimes we look within, actually within counties. The results here are within states of the U.S. For smaller firms, we match exactly on age category. We could match exactly on age. Actually, it doesn't matter. I see 3 to 5, which is my example. Normally, you know, differences are grouped together. And we match exactly on previous year employment, plus or minus 10%. So an average SBA recipient has an employment level of 11 prior to the loan. So that means for that size and smaller, we're matching exactly on employment. And then we do propensity score matching based on on lagged outcomes for 4 years prior to the loan and some other characteristics. And we're using kernel weighting of a bandwidth of 10% around the propensity score. Actually, we've looked at 5% and 2% and for the bandwidth, and it doesn't matter. so these are numbers of observations, about 200,000 treated firms. We have 3.5 million controls. And we have long time series before and after, an average of 9 to 10 years before and 5 to 6 years of information afterwards. So we can track these firms for a long time. Okay, I refer to specification checks. they include a couple of different pseudo outcome tests. So we're looking at pretreatment outcomes for the loan recipients versus non-recipients, and we look at nearby versus far away controls, motivated by the possibility that these kinds of loans are more available in some areas than others. And so one definition of far away controls are firms that are at least 50 miles away from any lender who gave out a loan in a particular year. And of course, we carry out conventional balancing tests for covariates. And here are the balancing tests. So we observe much more similarity, of course, between the treated and control firms than we do between the treated firms and the sample, in the LBD, the population as a whole. so if we look at employment with or without matching, first without matching, mean employment prior to treatment is, I said 11, here it says 12 employees. Post-treatment, it's 21 employees, so there's a gain of 9 employees, and in fact, a lot of the studies, like the telephone survey, they say, well, how many employees did you have before, and how many employees did you have afterwards? Oh, a gain of 9, successful program. But we probably wouldn't take that as very strong evidence. If we look at all non-treated firms in the LBD, so these are all employer businesses in the U.S., the mean employment is 16. so they start off smaller and they get bigger compared with average firms. After we match, we can compare the controls before and after, and you can see in the pre-treatment period, the employment is more similar, 11 compared to 12 employees, while post, both types have grown, conditional on survival, and the controls have grown to 19 and the treated to 20. Now the change is bigger, so the simple difference in differences estimate from that would imply a positive effect. We're not controlling for anything here. we can plot using the matched sample. we can plot their employment before and after the loan. So on the horizontal axis, zero refers to the year the loan is received. And so the solid line are the control firms, and the dotted one, the treated firms. And you can see there is a steeper slope for the treated firms, but also they're sloping up, and in fact, they're both sloping up prior to the loan year. So it doesn't look like, it looks like there's, you know, there's selection bias in the kinds of firms that are getting the loans. That is, firms that are growing faster prior to treatment receive loans, and then they continue to grow faster, and so they get bigger than the control firms. This is the same thing for median employment, and again, it's showing that there's faster growth prior to receipt of the loan. let's turn to regressions. And the way that I'm doing this, actually I've already started this procedure, is to take you from the crudest estimates, the kinds of estimates people have looked before, to our preferred estimates. And in each case, I'm going to look at the dynamics of the effect in order to try to evaluate the particular estimator. so here we're using only loan recipient firms, which is what has been a standard practice for consultants to the SBA. The SBA is not funding our research, by the way, unfortunately. But if you do that, you get in log points 328 impact. we also take into account the log loan amount in the second column, where we've taken the deviation from the mean log loan amount, so we can still include a post-loan dummy. And you can see getting a bigger loan also gives you a bigger employment effect according to these estimates. And we're also taking into account, we're trying to examine some non-linearities in this. I'm not going to spend much time on these results because, as you'll see in just a moment, we don't think they're very reliable, but most of the estimates I'll be showing you will have this form, so it's worth taking you through these. So we look both at log employment, because, you know, the world is probably proportional. We also looked at unlogged employment, which allows us to to take into account zeros in employment, especially when a firm exits. We're sometimes going to impute zeros there. and we have direct estimates then also of the number of jobs created. So at the mean, 3.6 jobs according to these results from treated firms only. So the pre versus post mean employment difference. And we estimate this also with loan amounts. And here, this is kind of interesting because the main effect of the post-loan dummy, not interactive, then is telling you something about what the data say the impact is of loan receipt per se, even if the amount is zero, right? So if the loan is having an impact even when the amount is zero, then it might make us a little suspicious again of residual selection bias. Of course, it could just reflect something about the functional form of the relationship. So we that's why we have a quartic interaction. but when we look at the dynamics here, so this is the kind of graph we get, and this is a 99% confidence interval around the estimated effects. So again, you can see there's a steep rise prior to loan receipt when we look at the treated firms only. So the absence of a control group here means that we can't exclude the possibility that those results are entirely driven by selection bias. We can also carry out an analysis where we where we do regressions, but we don't do matching. So we used an entire LBD sample just to illustrate what we get from doing it this way. And I'm going to, these results actually look pretty similar to the previous ones in terms of both the logged employment effect and unlogged employment effect. And actually the dynamics look kind of similar also. So once again, it seems that there's still some residual selection bias. So now we'll turn to the results that we prefer. So this is combining matching with regression, and we're estimating about a 24% impact of getting a loan on employment, and this amount is again increasing in the amount of the loan, although there's some concavity to the shape. When we look at this in terms of unlogged employment, about 3 jobs, so a bit less, actually not all that much less, but a bit less than the previous estimates. And this main effect of the post-loan dummy, when we include the loan amounts, becomes much smaller. The point estimate becomes 0.7 just by including the one linear interaction of loan amount, and statistically insignificant. And it basically goes to zero once we include a quadratic interaction, even goes negative when we include the quartic. So what these results are saying is that loan receipt per se doesn't do anything for these firms. It's all about the amount of the loan that they receive. And these are the dynamics from the regression with the match sample. So prior to loan receipt, they're actually estimated to be slightly worse than the loan recipients are estimated to be doing this very slightly worse. These are small numbers, around minus 0.03, so about 3% less employment, since we're talking about firms with 11 or 12 employees on average. That's a pretty trivial difference, although it is statistically significant. Statistical significance is not hard to achieve with our sample sizes. But notice what happens in the loan year. Immediately, employment starts to jump, and it continues to jump rapidly 1 year out, and continues rising all the way out for 10-plus years. So these are all years grouped together, 10 years and after the loan is received. So there's a long run impact of loan receipt, and at least this specification test doesn't give any evidence of selection bias in the loans received. Now, one thing that we do is we look at various subsamples, slice the data in different ways. One argument that's interesting is that because the selection bias problem we're worried about is that firms with a higher growth potential, with a higher demand, essentially, for the loans are those that are getting them. We look at counties that are rapidly growing. So they are in the top decile of growing counties in the U.S. and the idea is that those are counties in which basically every small firm has a chance to grow. And we just tried to see whether the results are any different. The answer is they're not. They're almost exactly the same coefficients. in that regression, maybe slightly smaller, this suggests slightly smaller number of jobs per loan. and these are the dynamics in these growing counties. So in the growing counties, it looks like the treated firms are slightly better and the non-treated firm controls. but there, the result is not statistically significantly different. And again, in the loan year and subsequently, employment rises. How am I doing for time?
Two or three minutes.
Okay, so we want to look at displacement because there's We suspect the possibility about the SBA loan program that one firm receiving this this loan may be able to get some competitive advantage over some other firms in its industry and region. And so one way to look at that is to think about a model of monopolistic competition based on distance. So the closer a competitor to you is, then the stronger the product market competition. And the farther away, then the less likely they are to be a competitor, and so less likely to be displaced. Have their business displaced as a result of the loan. And so we look at nearby versus far away firms in a variety of ways, and the bottom line is that the coefficient estimates, which you can see here, these are four different sets of regressions using control groups within 10 miles of the, so that's about, 16 kilometers, of the recipient firm, or more than 200 miles away, or we take the nearest four competitors. So within that that kernel bandwidth that we're using, we can take the nearest four in the same industry and meeting all the other criteria, including propensity score, and the farthest four away. The estimates are pretty similar across them. These are the unlogged ones. Here we have the results by distance, and again, they look pretty similar regardless of the distance away from the treated firm. And we can also use use these controls divided by distance to carry out another kind of pseudo outcome test. So what we've done here is we've excluded all the treated firms. And we're using two control groups. One control group is less than 10 miles away from the recipient, and the others are more than 50 miles away from all SBA loan recipients. So they're just in places where nobody got an SBA loan that year. We treat the first group as though they've gotten a placebo. So we impute a one for the post-loan dummy for them, and we're going to see if there's a difference in the outcomes for these two groups. And the answer is there's a small difference, minus 0.019, so about 2% smaller growth in the nearby competitors versus those farther away. So there might be a very small displacement effect that could account for these results, but it is really quite tiny, and it's dwarfed by the outcome that we estimate. Okay, so just concluding, so these results suggest that actually these firms are credit constrained, and so the loan program helps them. They're consistent with a 24% employment gain, three jobs at the mean in the sample. It's not about the loan received per se, as I said, but the size of the loan, and we're getting about 5.4 jobs per million dollars of loans. And so if you try to calculate the SBA cost of that, it's a little bit difficult. There's a default rate, and so there's also a variation in the, which is, the default rate is kind of controversial, actually, and there's also a difference across loans in the SBA exposure, but these are really cheap jobs by U.S. standards. The effect appears to be permanent, increasing in the long run, which might be explained by some crowding in effect once these firms maybe are getting their first access to formal credit markets by virtue of this program, and having established a credit history, then it allows them to get further loans. and the displacement effects we estimate are small. So, thank you very much.
Thank you, John. I will ask if there are questions. Please, Andreas.
Thank you. Alright, thank you for an excellent presentation. I have many questions, but I have one basic clarification question, which is about the nature of the data. So these SBA loans, the database covers all loans to all small businesses in the U.S., is that right?
No, all loans that are supported by the SBA to right. Small businesses.
So actually in your control group, you do have firms potentially who got funds from other sources. But then your estimates are, in a sense, a lower bound because
our estimates are of the program effect, so they're not the effect of access to finance in general.
Okay. And then, of course, I wanted to ask you about, you had to skip over the institutional details. But, you know, thinking in terms of, okay, such a program, if such a program were applied in Russia or in other of Commonwealth countries, what do you think are the lessons to be learned from the U.S. program for Russian?
Yeah, that's what I'm supposed to be talking about, right? as I mentioned at the beginning, we also carried out a study in Romania. Those were of U.S. aid loans, micro and small business loans there. And remarkably, to an uncomfortable extent, the coefficients are really similar to these. The cost per job is a lot lower, but the logged employment effects are very similar. So, I used to have no opinion about these sorts of loan programs or industrial policy. Now I think, there really is a credit constraint problem for some firms, and these programs are helpful. So, whether a particular program implemented in a particular country would have the same effect is difficult to say. But I think it would be great to evaluate. And there have been very few program evaluations that use firm-level data. Most program evaluations, the classic ones, are about worker training. I hope there will be lots of future studies along these lines.
Please, Andreas.
Well, congratulations for this really fascinating study. I think even starting from the organization of the data and matching the various information that you have collected, that's already a masterpiece, I would say. However, looked at the end, the results, for my taste, are nearly too good to be believed to be true. If this is, let's say, the final word, then the extent of being credit constrained for small businesses, but already existing businesses. You said you exclude startups, so you have already excluded those businesses that, let's say, where a lender has a suspicion whether that is something reasonable or not. But these are businesses that every lender can observe. Yeah,
We do. We have one-year-olds here. We just don't have the businesses in their very first year of.
Yeah, exactly. But that is what I mean. But nevertheless, let's say you find that these firms, and they have to the lender has to sign a statement that he wouldn't give a loan to this company otherwise, without the guarantee support of this program. And then you come to the conclusion that if this program would not exist, there would be 24% less employment in these companies.
In the recipient companies.
In the recipient companies,
right.
Yeah.
Which is a small fraction of all U.S. companies, of course.
Yes, but still, it is Well, you have about 1 million. You have 1 million companies that you have looked at. So it isn't so small. And you spoke about 500 or 600,000 employment opportunities that are created every year.
Actually, I'd love to be able to clarify that because while the SBA is claiming, that's their claim, 500,000 to 600,000 jobs created per year, well, our estimates are big. I also think surprisingly big, implying large employment increases associated with this program. It's much smaller than the SBA is claiming. So maybe by a factor of three or so. So the range, depending upon how you calculate this, is something like 180 to 200,000 jobs per year. So the SBA hasn't seen this yet, and I think they're going to be very unhappy. In fact, even though. You know, it's just their number was foolish. It's based on nothing.
to come to my question at the end, I mean, is there an opportunity to compare the stochastic characteristics of these loans that are supported, and comparable loans that are provided by lenders without that support?
We don't have data on non-SBA loans. Zero data on that.
Yeah, may I ask some questions? It's quite interesting. So, I'm wondering, do you have more heterogeneous fundings concerning, is the loan more effective for the young firm for the old firm? And also, which sector benefit more? For example, is manufacturer or is the service sector? And at the beginning, you also mentioned that you are talking about the general equilibrium effect. So is that the displaying effect you mentioned?
Yes.
Okay.
I think the answer to all your questions is yes, except there was the one about the sector. So this is covering all sectors. The SBA loans tend to be a bit more in manufacturing than other sectors, but we haven't yet looked at sectoral differences. And so that's another thing on the list. Yeah.
Any other question, please? Anton.
I mean, one question which regards specification. I mean, maybe I missed it completely. How does loan size enter the story here? So basically, from what I understood from presentation, it's not about the loan size, it's about the size of the guarantee itself. So firms receive, well, SBA gives a guarantee for a loan, So guarantee might cover 20% of the loan, it might cover 50% of the loan. So basically, and it wouldn't be the size of the loan itself then. Well.
So the variable in the regressions is the size of the loan, not the size of the guarantee. The guarantee ranges from 50 to 85%. It's not as low as 20%. We actually haven't looked at the guarantee percentage yet. We haven't looked at the term of the loan or the interest rate. There are also differences in the screening process for different types of loans. So all those program characteristics we plan to look at. But, we haven't done that yet. So this is about loan amount.
May I ask also a question? In the meantime, somebody else can think about is there any incentive for firms to show that they hired more people in the institutional context? It may be that firms have this interest. So you show that the growth of employment is pretty constant and it remains there for 10 years or more, because it may be a problem in public finance or public support to firms that after some time the rent-seeking behavior is, just take the money when the program is finished, let's say after 5 or 10 years, then the firm is closing down or something like that. So I worry whether there is any incentive for firms to declare more employment than actually is in the long term. And the second question is, you didn't talk much about the default rate. So it may be that there is some selection in terms of firms that are actually included in the study, but were given loans. Other firms were given loans, but were not included in this study. Probably, I don't know. Perhaps I didn't catch something.
So the source for the employment data is not any report to the SBA or survey data or anything like that. These are the essentially the unemployment insurance records of the firm. So these are the employees for which the employer is paying the unemployment insurance tax. So I don't think they have any tendency to overstate and. These are pretty trusted numbers in the U.S. and I'm sorry, the second question. The what?
The default rate.
Yeah. So actually, the last point here in the conclusions, which I think I skipped over. So we've started to look at exit. The only way that we've really explicitly taken into account exit in these kinds of numbers is by imputing zeros, as I said, for firms post exit, and those have essentially no effect on these results. However, exit is an interesting. In its own right, and there's some suggestion in the data. We plan to estimate hazard functions normalized around the loan receipt time to see whether the loan tends to raise or lower exit, and it could go either way. In fact, there's some suggestion in the data that firms receiving larger loans, ceteris paribus, are more likely to exit. Well, you know, that means they're more. They're more vulnerable to shocks, and so you know that would make sense from a finance point of view. Again, the SBA would be most unhappy to hear that, but that's what the data seemed to suggest. In Romania, there was no effect of the loans on exit. Exit rates were the same for recipients and non-recipients.
Any other question? If not, we can have a coffee break now. Thank you. Thank you.
So, dear all, so we are ready to start a new session. Да, attention, please. Никак. So I'm sorry to interrupt your interesting discussions, but we are ready to start. So we are going at least to start a new session. So now we are moving to a topic of economic shocks and job insecurity. So, and I am happy to pass floor to our first presenter, who is Olga Lazareva, and she is going to talk about the effects of transition on children's outcomes.
Let me start. My interest in this topic, this research project in general stems from my general interest in the topic of in the process of human capital accumulation, and there is a growing interest in economics literature towards studying the human capital formation and development, in particular during childhood. And there is a growing body of evidence that, in particular, certain negative influences during starting from prenatal period and during early childhood may have a long-term impact, consequences for child development and for his or her future outcomes in adulthood. And this kind of negative influences which were studied in the literature summarized, for example, in the survey by Almond and Curie, could include, of course, various infections in early childhood, poor nutrition due to different reasons, poor ecological conditions, and also an important topic is economic shocks to the family during early childhood or person. But in fact, there are not many studies on the effect of the labor market shocks that faced by parents of a child on future outcomes of a child. There are a couple of studies that found on the effect of job loss by parent on future wages of this child when he grows up, she grows up. And they use this typical, also in the job loss literature, they use plant closure. Data and show one study shows significant effect, another study doesn't find an effect. But in general, there are not much evidence on this issue, how labor market shocks faced by parents affect children and their future outcomes. And the outcomes that may be affected, that are studied and looked at in the literature, include health. Of a person, school enrollment, school graduation, performance in school and in college, and later in the life cycle, employment and wages. Also possibly risky, various risky behaviors. So all kinds of outcomes related to studying, working, and health. In this study, I'm trying to do exactly this, try to estimate the effect of negative labor market events faced by parents of a child of preschool age, early age, on the, their outcomes in adolescence. And of course, if we just have a parent, a family where a parent lost job, for example, then this event may be correlated with some unobserved characteristics of this person, of this parent, which also may affect child outcomes, of course. So there may be this selection into who experiences this labor market shocks, who loses jobs, loses income, and this results in biased estimates, of course. Kind of a natural experiment set in the early transition in Russia completely eliminates this problem, but helps to reduce the selection bias because there was this exogenous shock and to the economy, to the labor market, and moreover, this shock was degree of the shock was differentiated by, for example, by sector where a person was employed, because we'll see later in the data the different sectors were differently affected by this initial shock of transition. So that's why I'm trying to do it in this setting. And before going to the background, the data and the background, I would like to just to fix some ideas, just to present the very simple theoretical framework developed in several papers by Kuhn and Heckman on how human capital accumulates during childhood. And this helps to understand further how I address estimate and interpret estimates that I obtain. So we can view, the human capital as a kind of broad category which covers different things. And what is usually distinguished in the literature is cognitive capital, theta C, non-cognitive abilities, which are more and more recognized as very important driving forces behind parent outcomes, and also health capital, theta H. So this is a vector of individual capabilities, where a person is born with some initial endowment, and then this human capabilities develop further, and in this framework, theoretical framework, there is a specific technology, not a specific, it's kind of general, but the technology of capability formation, when next period capabilities is a function of previous period endowment of capabilities plus some investment, which may be done by parents into the child, which may be done by the person, him or herself. And in order to accommodate the existing evidence from the psychological literature, health literature and economics literature, there are certain that it is important in which period of childhood this investment is made. Technology of capability formation is characterized by complementarity of capabilities with investment. And this is both recent period static complementarity, meaning that higher endowment of capabilities in this period increases the productivity of investment in this period into future endowment. And this, since the future endowment depends on previous investments, this means also dynamic complementarity of investments, meaning that what parents, for example, invest currently, for example, in early childhood, into child development, it also raises future capabilities, which in turn raise return to future investment. So there is complementarity between investment today and investment tomorrow in the child, and this leads to this notion of sensitive critical periods of child development, when it is important when investments into certain, for example, in cognitive abilities are more productive than in other periods, and this is empirically confirmed in a lot of evidence in different fields of literature. So in terms of my setup, or more generally types of investment that parents do in their children, usually we talk about money and about time. So parents can make monetary investments and they can invest their time, which is also important. So both of these investments, of course, income of parents and time they're able to spend with children can be affected by labor, by job loss, by income decline, by the necessity to take additional job, and meaning that you would spend less time with the children and so on. So this kind of labor market shocks, they affect investments in children of parents, and it is important. It makes difference when this happens during childhood, at least for the cognitive abilities. It's well established that investments are more productive early in childhood years, and disadvantaged kids, if they're disadvantaged in early childhood, is less efficient to invest in them later in childhood in terms of increasing their cognitive abilities. Another contributing factor of labor market shocks is related to psychological stress in the family. If these are stressful events, there are also studies and psychologists showing that the stress experienced by parents negatively affects in some ways their children, and this effect also may be stronger in early childhood or a person. So, of course, in the studies I don't need to explain much and talk much about the economic transition in Russia in the 90s, just for some of you to remind the main facts, main figures. We know that there was a 40% fall in GDP during the first half of the 90s, so it was quite rapid growth in unemployment, and there were deep structural shifts in the economy that led to this large-scale labor allocation, which I will show in the picture in a minute. We know from studies that there was, due to that cross-sectoral reallocation, there was a large extent of occupational change. People had to move to completely new occupations. And there was also large-scale non-payment of wages by enterprises. So in general, we know that there was this way of adjusting of the labor market to this deep crisis. Not so much through the shedding labor, through job loss, but also to a large extent by various declining real wages and various forms of non-payment, underpayment, and various forms of underemployment. So we need to take this when talking about labor market shocks. I will not be talking only about job loss, but also other forms, other negative consequences. This is just to illustrate this cross-sectoral shifts, change in employment, during 90s across different sectors. We see the declining employment in industry and construction, and growing, these people growing into growing market services sector. And also within, if we look within the industrial sector, this is the dynamic of industrial output by sector. We also see that what I already mentioned, that different sectors suffer differently from the initial shock. For example, the fuel industry output has fallen by about 30%, while textile has fallen by almost 90%. This shows that the most of the decline happened exactly in the first half of the 90s, so it was kind of a period of most rapid and the most exogenous changes to the labor market position of people employed. So that's why I'm taking this initial period from 91 to 95 to measure the labor market shocks experienced by parents. The data I'm using, most of you also know, the Russian Longitudinal Monitoring Survey. So I'm taking the children born during transition data for them in 2009. Since it's a household survey, I can link children to their parents, and we observe parents in earlier waves. And in particular, in 2006 round, the respondents who were working in the beginning of 90s, who were employed in the beginning of 90s, they were asked retrospective questions about their labor market history starting from 1991. There were several questions to measure, to find out what happened to them. And one is more general questions when the respondents were asked to point three worst years, most general formulation, worst years of their professional activity from 1991 to 2006. So I'm taking it as one of the indicators of the labor market shock, those who say that these worst years happened in the beginning of 90s, from 91 to 95. And there are more specific questions, whether a person lost a place of work, not just lost, but because of the enterprise closed or conducted reductions in staff members. So it's not exactly plant closure, but also includes large labor shedding in firms. Whether a person had to change the debt formulation, had to change work for another permanent job which didn't correspond to person's qualifications, which can be interpreted as occupational downgrading, where a person doesn't use his or her skills in this new job. Whether a person had to take on additional job, which also happened in many cases, and whether the salary of a person decreased substantially. As I said, many people weren't fired from the enterprises, but they were paid less or weren't paid for some time. In the paper, I don't have a table here, but in the paper I showed that indeed this the occurrence of these events in the early 90s is indeed significantly related to the change, to the decline in the employment in the sector where a person was employed in 1990. So it's indeed a lot of these events happening are driven by the decline in the sector where a person was employed, shock to the sector. This is how this data look like. So by year, the percentage, the sample answers the situation in 2006, the percentage who answered positively to these questions for each year. So indeed, we see that the more higher share of people experience these events in the early 90s, the peak year is 93 here. So the among more specific things, this most often people experience salary decline. And the next category is loss of job loss. So I'm just calculating this, taking parents of children who found in the 2009 wave, and for them, for parents, I take indicators whether this happened to the parents from 91 to 95. This is the main explanatory variables which I use. As for the estimation strategy, so as I said, I'm taking the 2009 data. And first, I'm doing just a cross-sectional estimate for this sample. And actually, I'm taking two samples in order to test whether indeed it is important when during the childhood this negative event happened. in a family of a person. So I'm taking one cohort, children who are indeed born in transition just before that, from the 81 to 95, and they are aged from 4 to 14 to 20 in 2009, so they enter, they answer in the questionnaire, adult questionnaire in 2009. And the second cohort of older kids born in 81 to 86, who were, which means they were at the school age during the transition. And doing estimates for both cohorts, estimating the effect of this parental shocks on children's outcomes. Of course, although the shocks were kind of, were caused by this sectoral shocks, of course, there is still a place for unobserved heterogeneity effects, and cross-sectional estimates cannot be readily interpreted as causal estimates. So what I'm able also to estimate here to deal with this problem is what is often estimated in the literature, sibling fixed effect model, meaning that I'm taking those born in transition during the early transition and their older siblings, which were born during the 80s, and basically estimate kind of difference in the outcomes between the siblings within the family, which controls for all unobserved characteristics of a parent or a family and of location where a person was growing up. So this is the way to deal with unobserved heterogeneity of family. The only problem is significant reduction in size of the sample, because of course not all of the children in the sample have older siblings. These are the outcomes which I no this these are the just figures on to show the extent of the to which this, these two cohorts are affected by parental shocks. So for the two cohorts, the percentage of this cohort which were affected when the mother or father experienced one of these events, and we see it's quite significant, so about 20, it's a bit higher for all the cohorts, so 20 to 24%. Families of these kids experience job loss, either mother or father, significant proportion experience occupational downgrading, salary decline, and this is any shock in any of these four events, 35 to 40% of families experience that. So it's indeed the large part of these cohorts were affected by these labor market shocks. The outcomes which I'm able to measure from LMS data, this is a health indicator, the standard self-rated health on the scale from 1 to 5, whether the person completed high school, meaning completed 10 or 11 grades and got the high school diploma. Here I have to take only those who are older than 18 and older in the younger cohort. Whether a person smokes, whether a person ever drank alcohol, another health related indicator available is body mass index, which is adjusted for age, for those senses. It needs to be adjusted for age. Both high and low BMI is kind of considered to be bad for health, and in particular, according to this measure, about 5% of younger cohort can be considered underweight, which is supposedly bad for their health. So this is just an additional indicator of related to health, to measure health. So the basic model I'm estimating is this one, where the dependent variable is one of the outcomes measured in 2009. Z is one of the indicators of the labor market shocks, which I presented. And I also control for a number of characteristics available. Of course, you control for gender, age of a child, whether he or she lives with parents currently in 2009, and for available family characteristics. In particular, I can talk for mother's education, whether mother worked, didn't work after after 1990, for the family size, whether father is absent in the family, and for the population of size of population or place where a person lives. And since the indicators are mostly binary, health is on a scale from 1 to 5, I estimate other probit for health and probit, binomial probits for other indicators. So this is cross-sectional estimates, and sibling fixed effects models are basically the same, but without family characteristics because they're controlled for, but with family fixed effects. So the estimation results for the two cohorts, main cross-sectional estimates are these ones. So in some specification, each estimation comes from separate regression. I'm not showing all the controls, of course, just main variables of interest. So I include either one indicator where whether any parent had worst years, reported worst years, or other event in this period. Also, I include separate indicators for mother and father to see the differential. So this is from one regression, this is from another regression. This is any shock, meaning any of the four, any of the job loss, occupational downgrading, salary decline, or additional work. So we see, if you look at first at the self-rated health, we can see significant negative effect for a young cohort. In particular, if it's driven by father, whether father had problems with his job in the early 90s. And whether any parents experienced any specifically market shock, there's also negative significant. For the older cohort, we also see this significant negative effect from the father, although overall effect not significant. So it looks like health is affected in both cases, but probably more strongly, more significant in case of young people. If we look at high school graduation, high school completion, we also see negative effects again of others' bad experience in transition, negative effect of labor market shocks, and we don't see any significant effects for the old public works. Okay, so this difference basically, come to it later in sibling fixed effects also. Other variables, so another health indicator, low BMI, is high probability of low BMI for young people who are experiencing parental shocks in the 90s. And as for smoking and drinking, the more significant effects are basically we observe for older cohorts. So while their health is less affected and their high school completion rates are not affected, they are more likely children who experience the shocks of in older age, at school age, they are more likely to display this risky behaviors, smoking and alcohol consumption. Just briefly, in more detail, I'm showing this more specific effect on more specific shocks for young cohort or for those born in transition. So it seems the health effect comes from occupational downgrading and from salary cut experienced by parents, also wage arrears. This is, I can use it as a separate indicator because there are not many observations on wage arrears because it comes from earlier years. Here we also see actually effect on drinking consuming alcohol for young people. And school completion, This effect mainly comes from also from salary decline, and as far as I remember, it's also mainly driven by father, where the father experienced this loss of income in the family, significantly affects, negatively helps, affects health and education. So for all the cohort, the same salary cuts also affects health, no effect on schooling, as I said. And say the significant effect on smoking, drinking comes from occupational downgrade, mostly, and also job loss by one of the parents. Finally, coming to the sibling fixed effects estimation, here what I summarize through this in these results is whether mother experienced any kind of labor market shock negatively affects health in this case, and also wage rate experienced by father that had negative effect. As for the schooling, again, the strongest results in sibling fixed effects model are for schooling. There is negative effect on high school completion, and negative coefficients for smoking and drinking, since it's we are kind of comparing the younger sibling to older sibling, means that there is positive effect for older siblings, for older generation, which we saw in the cross-sectional estimates. The results, we see some negative health effect, and also the negative effect on education, on high school graduation. As I said already, there are some important issues with the sibling fixed effects model. Although it helps to get rid of this family and observed characteristics, the sample size in these estimates is much smaller, which of course reflects in precision of estimates. Of course, we use only it's kind of local effect, right? Like a local average treatment effect, because it's only for the families with siblings who have more than one child. We exclude all, majority of families, right, who have only one child from this analysis. And also, this analysis kind of assumes that younger siblings are treated while older are not. In fact, we understand that kind of both older siblings are also treated, but to a lesser extent. If we believe in this story that shocks are more important to early childhood, affect stronger. So in this estimation, it means that this model kind of underestimates the total effect from the economic shock on child outcomes. So, to conclude, I show in this estimation that health of children, future health of children, is indeed negatively affected by labor market shocks faced by parents, to a larger extent by younger children, those who are born in transition are affected. And unfortunately, I cannot distinguish between prenatal period and effects and postnatal effects after birth, but part of the effect may come from prenatal period as well, experienced by mother during the transition. Schooling effect, with negative schooling effect, I find for younger cohort, and I didn't show this estimates now, it seems that this effect is driven by girls. So it's just, when I do separate estimates for boys and girls, I find significant effects only for girls. As for this older cohort, so what is significant, what seems to be affected in the older cohorts is that we observe high incidence of smoking and alcohol consumption for kids who experience these parental shocks during their school years, and this may be related to behavioral problems during adolescence to these children. So in general, we can take it as an evidence of the that children of preschool age, indeed, early age, indeed seem to be, in this case, more vulnerable to economic shocks to their families than older children. This part potentially is important for understanding the long-term consequences of economic crisis and for possible early remediation policies to remove these negative effects. Kim, questions?
So thank you for your presentation. Are there any questions, comments?
Thank you, Olga, for the presentation. I had a question regarding the possibility that you might have a sort of sample selection here. In particular, imagine if you have heterogeneous effects of these shocks in early transition. I mean, what I'm thinking is, if you have a family that has a single child, that family actually might be able to handle much better a shock than a family that has more than one child, that has two children. When you use this methodology, you're forced to use families that have several children, right? Because they're comparing across. So in a sense, it might be exaggerating the effect in that sense. And I think that one way that you might want to consider, I don't know if you have enough families with three children. If you had, maybe you could compare families with two children and families with three children and see if this, if there's an effect of that.
There are very few observations of families with three
children. And one more point is also, I wonder if, I was trying to think if you can actually distinguish the effect that you find from simply the effect of being the older child or being the younger child.
I can't tell for age, or you mean the order of birth. Yeah, it's not controlled here, but I need to control for that as well.
Sorry, so maybe, I was not following exactly, but one thing that you could try to address this particular issue is to compare both, cohorts that are born later and earlier. And that way you can sort of see.
Sorry?
All right, so my question was, can you distinguish from the effect of being born in early transition from simply the effect of, because my understanding is that you're comparing two cohorts, right? The one born earlier and one born later.
Yeah, but in both cohorts there are first child, second child.
But then your comparison is always between the older child and the younger child in the family, right?
Sibling fixed effects, yes.
Yeah, but then maybe what you could do is also compare with children born before. And then, then you will have both...
Not the siblings.
No, they would be siblings, but you will have... All right, maybe I can explain this better in person.
I think this is a really interesting paper. And you have two cohorts you're studying, the 81 to 86 and 89 to 95. Well, I mean, birth is itself endogenous to economic conditions, right? So why wouldn't the natural cohort to study be actually, in between both of those, the ones born just prior to transition, so, when things were relatively stable, and then the shocks came?
Yeah, I can do that as well. The initial idea was just to see, to take this cohort from early 80s, because they're older, right? They are school age in transition, to see whether indeed there are differences by periods of childhood, which is an idea in literature. But those born in late 80s, they're closer in age, they're younger during transition, but this I can do it as well.
But my point is that, so if the shock happened in the early 90s to a family, then they may not have had another kid born during that period. So your results would then understate. But because you have there's a selection on birth.
Right.
Going.
Well, that depends on whether this child wasn't born at all, or whether it was the birth was delayed and maybe beneficial for a child.
So you don't have those in your sample, and
no, because there are still children or the adolescent, or if they're born later, there are still children.
Now, the, your result that younger children are more vulnerable is, of course, very reasonable, and that's also a reason for lots of social for the motivation of social policy interventions and things of that sort. However, it might be interesting to see whether you could further differentiate this result by, let's say, using information. This is a question whether you have this information available, whether the parents or the children that have been in such difficult situation had access to social services like kindergarten or welfare services. Yeah. And I guess the transition shock, especially in Russia, was even more serious than in other countries because of the breakdown of social services that were provided by enterprises. And so that could add an interesting additional feature to your very nice result.
It's a good idea as well. And the data start in 94, but I could try to derive some information from the data on the services. Try to see.
One technical question. How do you qualify cases when persons didn't complete high school but completed technical colleges, either vocational schools?
So I qualify them as zero,
not
graduate from high school. I didn't get the high school. I just started. One can introduce several categories here to study it. But I wouldn't equate completely those who studied, graduated from high school, 11 years, and those who
completed technical colleges.
Huh? I would still differentiate. No. And another thing, possible thing, is to look at this starting from 18 years, those who, because those who graduate school, they also, some of them could go to college, others wouldn't go to college, and possibly one can look at this as well. So I agree that maybe more. I may differentiate more here between different categories of schooling.
To make it a try, the only way the survey to see the outcomes of children is only basically the households where children still live with their parents, right?
No, I take all persons born in this cohort in 2009. And some of them don't live with their parents anymore, but I trace these children back and find, if I find the year when they lived with their parents, I can, from household roster, I can figure out who their parents are. If they're followed from the age when they started living separately.
Yeah, but then you don't know the information about their parents, right? Just
certain. Yeah. Well, I still have observations which children who don't live with their parents, and I am able to find their parents.
This adds a little bit to what John said, actually, because I think there is a great deal of focusing on younger cohorts and older cohorts. And older cohorts have this selection potential, whether you don't observe either children.
Yeah, most of them, yes. Yes. Yeah, I need to look at this more, who is followed, who's not. Thank you.
So, thank you, Ola. So now we move to another presentation by Alexey Ashepkov. He will present his joint paper with Michael Lokshin and Vladimir Gimpelson.
Uh, I will present a paper on perceptions of job insecurity in Russia. So there are no papers in our conference that deal with perceptions of job insecurity, so I'll make some brief introduction to the topic. So it's not surprising nowadays that economists are interested not only in actual dynamics, factors and consequences of unemployment, so not only objective figures and objective unemployment rates, but also in subjective perceptions. And fear of unemployment is one of the such perceptions of job insecurity. And it affects human behavior. It can decrease wages, contain consumptions, negatively affect health, and suppress subjective well-being, and so on. There's a lot of papers showing that fear of unemployment or it's the same as subjective perception of job insecurity matter. Not only individual fears, but also distribution of the fear of unemployment across population is also of importance. For example, workers' subjective perceptions of unemployment traditionally considered indicators of efficiency, how employment protection functions. Or it may be that these workers' fears may be some measure of likelihood of future employment. So it could be like used as like a leading indicator of unemployment. And these fears also can be used by politicians or some, for example, labor ministry is responsible for employment programs. And when these fears are high, then labor ministry can receive more money to make these programs to combat unemployment. And also large enterprises can exploit these fears looking for subsidies from government. Have several previous studies on perceptions of job insecurity in Russia, and they generally show similar facts on Russia, similar to other countries, but there are some features. And two key facts which are important for our study. It's fact number one. In Russia, there is a very high level of fear of losing a job. And I will present some figures on it. And the second fact is that fear of unemployment is almost not associated with actual unemployment. And this is very interesting. So some figures describing these facts. For example, we can compare the index of fear of losing a job in different countries. And you can see that in Russia, it's located on the right side of this scale, this fear of losing a job is very high, much higher in developed countries. And we can know that in most post-communist transition countries, fear of unemployment is also high and comparable to what is in Russia. So the next comparison, we can compare what we observe in Russia with Latin America countries. And we see that in Latin America countries where there is almost no employment protection legislation and employment protection measures, these fears are comparable to what is in Russia. Of course, in 1998, the fears was very high in Russia. But even in 2004, in stable economic conditions and lower unemployment, these fears were not much less than in Latin American countries. So this picture is about dynamics of unemployment and perceptions of job insecurity. we can make some observations. So first of all, during the crisis, economic crisis of 1998, it was a sharp increase in unemployment, but it was not very large increase in share of Russian workers who feared to lose their jobs. You see that this indicator reacted from 60% to 70%. Another observation that the share of workers who appear to lose a job was persistently high. All the period, this share was never below 50%. And even in the period of economic growth and relatively stable economic conditions from 2001 to 2006 or 2007, it was above 50%. And this is so very interesting part. This is the main issue of our paper. Why it was so? And so during the financial crisis at the end of 2000s, we see that still the fear of loss of a job was relatively stable and almost didn't react to increased unemployment and crisis conditions. Another fact that if we use panel data from LMS, we can see that around 70% of workers who fear to lose job in the year T remained with this fear in the year T plus one. And that's true even if we look at 2 year period from 1998 to 2000. So 2 year period from economic crisis to growing economy, this share was about 70%. So these fears are stable. So this percentage of focus is stable, and if you look at transitions from different levels of fears, on the individual level, they are stable too. So we can summarize what we observe. And this picture should create a puzzle. So in most countries which related studies exist, these subjective perceptions of job insecurity or fears of unemployment are cyclical. So fear of job loss goes up when unemployment is on rise and goes down when it falls. And Russia looks different. So these perceptions were almost constant regardless of movements in unemployment and other economic conditions. And the question is, how can we explain this? And this is the main issue discussed in our paper. Use data from RLMS, a well-known Russian micro database. And we use two questions relating fear of unemployment. The first one is fear of losing a job, and the second one is fear of not finding a job. And answers to these questions are scaled, so it's from 1 to 5. 5 answers maybe 5 values, from very concerned to not at all concerned. And the same for fear of not finding a job. So this is the main question which we use in our study. And we construct a model which could help us to explain this puzzle. The main assumption of the model is that when answering the question of fear of unemployment, individual compares two utilities. Utility of being employed and expected utility of being fired. So utility of unemployment, so fear is difference of two utilities. Utility of being employed depends on wages and some individual and household characteristics. Next, we assume that wage consists of two components, fixed fixed part and variable part. And this is a known institutional feature of Russian labor market. There is a two-tier wage structure. So wage consists of two parts. And this variable part is linked to performance of the enterprise, performance of firms. And on average, it constitutes about 40% of total wage. So this share is very high compared to, for example, United States or I think many European countries. Expected utility of in part, it's a weighted average of two utilities, to find a new job and to be unemployed. So the weights are probability to find a job. So P is probability to find a job. It depends on expected wage. So this wage an individual expect to receive from new job. It's almost the same as a reservation wage. And this probability depends also, of course, on labor market conditions and some individual characteristics. Utility of being unemployed depends on unemployment benefits and also on some individual characteristics. Assume also that when searching for a job, an individual is not aware of the size of the mu at the future job. And she expects that this expectation that this variable part is zero. And then she expects that the wage of the new job, wage expected, will be the same as wage fixed at the old job. So he can forecast the size of the variable part because it depends on performance of enterprises. So this is the main structure of our model, and this is predictions of our model. First of all, we predict that when this variable part of wages increase, the fear of unemployment increases too. So this derivative with respect to variable part is positive. Then when probability to find job increase, then fear decrease. So this derivative of fear with respect to probability to find a job. And another feature of our Russian labor market that we have very low replacement ratio. About less than 10% unemployment benefits constitute less than 10% of average wages. So, and we receive such a picture, and we have. What we observe in growth? When economy grows, unemployment decreases, probability to find employment rises, but this variable part rises too, because average performance of firms increase. And in recession, unemployment rises, probability to find job decreases, but this variable part decreases too. So on the one hand, unemployment decreases, probability rises, and this fears decrease. But this is balanced by the influence of this variable part, which rises too. Okay, so in growth and recessions, we have two forces which operating in different directions. And potentially, it can explain this stable fears during the period of economic growth. Derivative of fear with respect to wage, expected wage, is the sign is not defined in the model, so it depends on it depends on other conditions, but it's not very crucial for our model and its estimation. So we have this function, that here is function of new variable part, probability to find a job, x, individual and household characteristics, and of course we include some unobserved factors affected here. And for in order to receive new, we estimate wage equation, and estimate for new is residual from this wage equation. We in linearized form we receive this equation for here, and we are interested in coefficients p and gamma. We expect that coefficient p is positive, so when this variable part increase, here increase too, and this coefficient gamma is negative when the probability to find a job increase, here decrease, fears to lose a job and to find a new one, decrease. And this proxy for these probabilities to find a job, this proxy original unemployment rates and also specific unemployment rates. So these unemployment rates calculated for workers of the same age, the same gender, located in the same region, and also in urban part of the region or in the rural part. So it's more specific unemployment rates for peers. And we estimate our model, our here variable takes five values, and we use ordered probability method. And we also make a robustness check, and we use semi-parametric maximum likelihood. In our estimation, we have usual problem of indigeneity. And here we have indigeneity of our new. For example, risk-averse individuals might accept stable jobs with lower compensation. Or it may be that somebody with connections to enterprise management can land high wage and at the same time a secure position. So we are not we can exclude that our new is correlated with our errors. In order to solve this problem, we use panel structure of our data. We assume that our variable part new consists of two parts, time-invariant component and time-variant component. And this source of indigeneity, it is this time-invariant component. And when we use fixed effect regression to estimate new, then we can get rid of this time-invariant component. So we can get rid of indigeneity. So these are main results for our estimations. And we estimate our model separately for men and for women. when we use simply ordered probability estimations, and when we use OLS estimations for in order to estimate this variable part of wages. We receive that there is a positive coefficient, positive relation, positive association between wage residuals and peers, as was predicted by our model. But association of regional unemployment and peers were only significant for women. For men, we didn't find this significant coefficient. So, and results are very similar for different methods. When we use fixed effect regression, results are almost the same. And when we use semi-nonparametric maximum, likelihood results are almost the same.
Sorry, just to clarify, what do you mean by log wage residuals?
Log wage residuals. Wage residual is new. Yes. Yes. It's a very variable part. Of wage consists of two parts: fixed part and okay. So we can see what we can see difference between how actual wages behave and how residual wages behave. So we start from the bottom picture. Here we can see how actual wages they are depicted by percentiles of wage distribution. So, and we can see that when the higher the wages, the lower the fear of unemployment. It is the bottom picture. Next, when we make the same picture, but we use residuals from wage equations. So, and these residuals reflect this variable part. We don't find this association. So, when these residuals grow, generally fears grow. So, if you take actual wage, total wages, this association is not the same when we use residuals. When we use estimate for variable part, so this connection change. And when we use fixed effect residuals, which help us to avoid this problem of endogeneity, which a little bit improves, but it remains the same. So there's a difference between actual wages and residual wages. And these residual wages are correlated with fears positively. And the same equations we estimate for the second our question here, not finding a job. So, and we receive results. They are similar to those which is for the first question. But here we receive that regional unemployment and other measures of unemployment, unemployment of peers, are positively correlated with fears. So, and these results are in line with our predictions of our model. Positive correlation with variable part of wages and positive correlation with unemployment. We made another robustness checks. We pulled samples with different number of periods, so not simply from 2000 to 2009, but we estimated this equation separately for different time periods. And as I said, we used alternative measures of unemployment, not just regional unemployment, but more specific unemployment of peers, of people with the same characteristics. And our results allow us to make some simple simulations. And the simulated scenario is, let's assume that individual wage residuals are constant over the years of the survey, and equal to the wage residuals in 2000. So we assume that this wage variable component is the same as in 2000. When we fix this variable component, we receive much higher correlations of fears with unemployment rates. And this is both on individual level and on the regional level. So when we fix this variable component, correlations becomes much more standard. Much more expected from results that we know from our studies. These fears became more cyclical. And of course, we discuss some possible alternative explanations of our, and we discuss whether at the background of this alternative explanation, whether our model can survive. First of all, it may be the case that answering this question on fear of unemployment, respondent evaluates probability of losing the job without comparison of utilities. Then the answers should correlate, these fears should correlate with unemployment rates. But we observe that fear are not only weakly correlated, if at all correlated. If you simply look at correlation of unemployment with these fears, there's no correlation, or very, very weak correlation. If you don't take into account this residual part, this variable part of wage. Another explanation that maybe non-random selection into unemployment. And individuals with highest perception of job insecurity, so they become unemployed and we don't observe them in our sample of employed workers. And this, during the recessions, individuals who are more concerned about losing their jobs are more likely to become unemployed. So we can receive this because of selection. And we test this possibility, and we show that fears of losing a job in year 10 minus 1 are not correlated with probability of becoming unemployed in year 10. We use the same LMS data, and we show that there is no correlation. And last alternative explanation we consider is that maybe this fear of unemployment is a part of common psychological background, background of fears prevalent in current population. It may be formed over a long period, by time, by history, religion, or culture, so it may be some predisposition to fears. And one of the fears is fear of unemployment, to lose a job. And another version of this explanation may be that these strong fears of losing job were formed in 1990s, in transition shock. And in this respect, this possible explanation connected to what Von Glazera presented to us is that people that were affected by these shocks, they have strong and relatively stable fears of unemployment after. And all that implies that change in unemployment rates and variance of wages have no effect of fear of unemployment. Yes, but still we show that both regional unemployment rates and this variance in wages, so this variable part of wages, are relevant. They are significantly correlated with individual perceptions. Of course, this result cannot exclude completely this possible explanation, but still it exists at the background of this possible transition shock. So, conclusions. We observe a puzzle. In Russia, perceptions of job insecurity are acyclical. They are not associated with differences with changes in actual unemployment. And this is not similar to what we observe in other countries. And we propose a model to explain this. The main features of our model is that fear is the difference between utilities of being employed and utility of being fired. And the second, that we exploit the fact that wages have a two-tier structure. They consist of fixed part and variable part. It depends on performance of enterprises. Our model predicts that positive correlation of fears not only with unemployment, but also with variable wage component. And this unemployment and this variable wage component, they operate in opposite directions. And that's why fears remain stable in time. And we estimated our model, and estimation results are in line with model predictions. And we simulated some scenario, and we show that if this variable part would be the same on the same level, then correlation of fears with unemployment would be much higher. That's all.
So thank you for your presentation. Are there questions?
Thank you very much, Alexei. I have a number. Well, this is very interesting. First of all, I have a number of things, actually, which sort of, well, some of them are more conceptual, some are more technical. One thing is that one of the key modeling assumptions is that the derivative of this fear of unemployment with respect to mu, this variable component of pay, is positive. I'm just wondering why, actually. I can give you an example. Imagine two wages. One is constant, essentially. There is no variable component. The other one doesn't contain any, basically, constant component, right? It's fully variable. So it entails, but the expected value of both is the same, right? The second option involves, basically, a lot of risk for the employee, right? So basically, increasing this mu, increasing this variable part, losing this job, number two, when everything is variable and there is no constant component, is much less a problem for an employee than losing a job with a good pay, basically fixed pay. Right? Why should we expect this derivative to be positive? I don't get it, basically. For me, losing a job with no variable pay would be a much more, much bigger problem than losing a sort of very risky job with a huge variable pay. So that's one thing. The other thing is that I'm wondering, actually, whether you can interpret this log wage residual as a measure of mu. Depends actually on what sort of labor market we are considering. Imagine that some firms are paying efficiency wages, right? In this case, basically your residual can measure the extent to which a particular firm overpays, essentially, above the market, right? So it's not a variable pay, it's just the quality of a particular job match or whatever, right? So in principle, I just think of that as, quality of this particular job match, not a variable pay component. And then, of course, you have a greater fear of losing this job when this residual is large. It means that you are sort of fearing of losing a very good job, very good, sort of destroying a very good job match. But there is nothing about essentially this variable pay here. The story is different. And the third thing, which is related to your regressors in the model, I'm just wondering how you can include this regional unemployment rate, because the RMS is not representative, basically, on the regional level, right? So you take some regional level data, but that's not a great control variable.
Okay, I'll start from last question. Of course, we calculated these unemployment rates not from RLMS, but we calculated them from labor force study. And we calculated for regions which are presented in RLMS from this another source, from labor force study. So your questions about residuals, whether they reflect a variable part which is linked to performance, or maybe they reflect something else. I think it's a good question. So generally, we don't know what is in the residuals, of course. And so I don't have ready answer to this question. I think we have to discuss at least this, maybe job match, maybe something else, of course. Okay, but still we expect that it reflects somehow this performance bonus for better performance. And why is fear is derivative of fear with respect to new is positive? It goes from our model, which where we differentiate our difference in utilities with respect to new, we receive that this derivative is positive because this new is not presented in expected utility of being fired. It exists only in wage. In wage, in utility of being employed, and actually this variable part may constitutes a very large part of total wages. So this effect, like the effect of losing a job with very high wage, but still it's not exactly the story, not exactly the what is important, not the amount of wage, but that this component is variable. It may not in the new job it may not exist. What this is the essence of this derivative. Maybe I didn't understand your question, but this is the answer.
Yeah, I shared the question about the variable part and the measure as the wage residual. I think, you know, so first a suggestion, then I have a different question. So you might try to measure it as actual variability of the wage rather than the wage residual, because then, you know, those are two different concepts. And usually when we think of the variable component, we think it can be varying, but you just have, you know, you have positive residuals in some years and negative residuals in other years, but, you know, so that's what you're using as your measure. But I have a different question. It's I'm a little puzzled about the results, because on the one hand, so you're motivating regularity is that there's little relationship between fear of unemployment and actual unemployment at the aggregate level, right, in Russia. But you do find such a relationship at the regional level, and then you don't find such relationship at the individual level. So, but you use at different points in your argument each of those three relationships to, I don't know, to counter the alternative explanations. So I guess I would interpret the RLMS question on fear of job loss as it being about the probability, and then the fear of not finding a new job as being the, you know, the quasi rents, so the utility difference, the quasi rents in a particular job or the quality of the job match. I'm not sure that, you know, that saying that there's little relationship between the fear of job loss and unemployment is really a response to that, because you do find such a relationship at the regional level, or so I understood. Overall, I think it's really interesting to see another paper on fear of job loss in Russia.
Yes, thank you for your comments. We are motivated from the picture what we observe on the aggregate data, first of all, and then we studied extensively this correlation between unemployment and individual fears on the micro level, and we didn't find almost no correlation of unemployment if we don't control for this residual part. So we studied in what is interesting, we even differentiated different jobs. Jobs from public sector, which are better protected, and jobs of private sector from small enterprises. And it was no difference between such jobs. People who from these jobs, they had the same level of fears. For both types of jobs, this there is no correlation with unemployment rates outside. But when we control for this wage variable component, which I think that link to performance, then we receive this correlation and it becomes a little stronger and more significant. That's maybe the answer.
May I add a couple of words? Well, about regional unemployment, we use different measures of unemployment. So unemployment measures, they are taken from labor force survey, which is, of course, much larger in the sample, yeah? So for some years, we have total sample, annual sample, like 265,000 observations, and for last years, we have almost 800. Even more. So, and then we can calculate, using this we can calculate, of course, just regular standard unemployment rates, or also we can design relatively small groups, people of the same age, the same education, the same, you know, the same gender, living in the same, in the same localities, of course, then we even having large samples, we get relatively small number of observations, but we can combine this criteria in different ways. So we have a number of unemployment rates, which we call peer unemployment rates. And then when we look at variation in fears and the background of this, you know, variation in peer unemployment rates, we have very large variation in unemployment, much larger than it's just on regional macro data, and fear remains relatively stable. So it's, and this is additional argument for this puzzle. And the second comment is on variable part. This is really, you know, very specific feature. And if you look, for example, using different data sources, how many people in Russia have variable part, don't have variable part? What is the proportion of variable part in total wages? And for example, if we compare to American story, and we have a number of papers on the United States where similar data are provided, and then we see that there is real contrast between United States and Russia, and some data on European Union and Russia, again, there is real difference. So it's a contrast which you cannot just, you know, to say this is, it's something insignificant. So the idea is to use this because also we know that this variable part is very much linked to performance. Of course, many people work in the public jobs, and the question is how in public jobs this can be linked. There's no direct measure of performance, but then we see that public sector jobs, wages, they are linked to performance of local budget, because much of this public employment is paid from local budget. Local budgets depend on industrial structure of region. So if, for example, it's gas or oil region or resource-rich region or Moscow, St. Petersburg, the budgets are richer, and they share some of these revenues with people who are employed by local government. So it works not only in the private sector, it works in the public sector as well. So that's what I want to just to clarify why I think it's...
No, well, I'll try to be short. I mean, contrary to others, I find this modeling approach to include this variable wage component into the model of fearing to an explanation about fearing to lose the job. I find that very reasonable. I mean, if we would be in a perfectly flexible labor market, yeah, then for, let's say, unskilled worker, the fear to lose the job should actually be the same one as to get the job. I mean, it should be a flat line. You should never have there should be no cyclicality. And therefore, I find it very interesting to use this observation of this big flexible wage component to explain why the response, whether to fear to lose the job, doesn't change cyclically. So.
Am I right that your explanation presumes a kind of irrational behavior on the part of workers? They should know from their experience that variable part is much larger in booms, but when they form their expectations, they ignore this fact.
I would answer that maybe then they can expect that, if you assume that they are rational, but still they're not sure that when what will be on the new job. So they know what is going on the job that they have now. They worked there and they know how the wage they receive depends on performance, but what will be on the on another enterprise they don't know exactly. So maybe they expect that there will be some amount of wage, some part of wage which paid for better performance of firm, but it doesn't even depend directly on their personal performance. It depends on whole performance of the whole enterprise. So maybe you are right, maybe not.
I try to answer. So there is an example. I like it very much. So let's assume there are two cleaning ladies, yeah, doing the simplest work and having almost no specific skills, just to clean, yeah, and they are of the same age, of the same experience, of everything the same, and they live on the same street, and they work in a neighboring establishment. One of these establishments, this is Gazprom office, and another establishment is, let's say, a municipal kindergarten. So they do more or less the same work, they have the same human capital. Do they have the same wage? Probably not. And one of the, if you, for example, think that Gazprom cleaning lady wins because she has larger variable part, then if she loses the job, what is the alternative job for her? Alternative job to go to, let's say, kindergarten or another municipal institution, because Gazprom is just one Gazprom, not 100 Gazproms. It means enormous loss of utility. So if she understands that and expects the losses, then I think it could be rational.
Are there any other questions? So, if there are no questions left, I think that I may invite you to the canteen for the lunch.
Yes, I would like to draw your attention that we are 40 minutes late. So.
Thank you.